What's up, Doom Nation? We are back again. It is Skaggs and your captain, as always. Thank you guys for joining in for another Two Doom and episode. And we have a special guest here today. Skaggs, you want to introduce him?
Yeah, I mean, I think he should introduce himself. We got Dave from the Flat Earth Podcast on to have a discussion. What's going on, man?
I'm Dave from the Flat Earth Podcast, also known as Flat Earth Dave. If you're ever looking for me, just search for Flat Earth Dave. I seem to be everywhere. And you guys, I'm doing great. You guys believe the Earth is a spinning ball and are up for having a conversation. Do I have that correct?
Yes.
Yes. I mean, we're two open-minded individuals. We're willing to talk to anybody about anything. We're not judgmental or mean or anything like that. Yeah. Unless you're a crazy woke liberal, blue
person. Absolutely not. We're on the same page on a lot of things. And by the way, when I learned about Flat Earth, I was closed-minded. I didn't believe anything. Right. But I want to point out that our backgrounds, I'm showing a real video of the Earth and you're showing a fake photo of the Earth.
Yeah, this is the moonrise. Famous moonrise photo from Apollo whatever. I just put it in there just to be a troll. For it.
No worries. Your microphone's super hot in my ears. Maybe it's just me or I don't know if you want to turn it down a little bit.
Sure.
So just let me give you, I'll give you a quick synopsis of what Flat Earth isn't, what Flat Earth is, and then you guys hit me with questions. Does that sound like a good format? So
let's go for it.
So in the heliocentric model, which is the globe model, you have to believe that besides nothing exploding and becoming everything, that we're spinning at 1,000 miles an hour. So the Earth at the equator is rotating at 1,000 miles an hour, right? It's also orbiting the sun at 66,600 miles an hour. Funny number, but we'll just go with that. 66,600 miles an hour. And it's also chasing the sun at almost 500,000 miles an hour. Okay. All of these motions are going on in your heliocentric model. I didn't know this. I never really thought about it when I was a heliocentrist. Right.
Yeah. I'm familiar with it. Right. Like the solar system, I guess you could say, is moving through space as one.
Yeah.
Entity,
yeah.
Right. That's how I understand it.
So we're all the planets are keeping up with the sun, in this elliptical orbit, and we're orbiting. Let's just talk about the orbit, which is what they taught us in school. You know, we knew that we were spinning. We knew that we were orbiting. We didn't necessarily know that we were chasing the sun. But if you look at the orbit speed, this is a hypersonic sled. It goes by a Mach 8.6. Take a look. Don't blink. There it goes. All right. You have to believe that if you believe in the heliocentric model, that we are spinning 10 times faster than that. We're chasing the sun at 90 times faster than that, speeding up and slowing down in a curved elliptical orbit and, two different orbits. And we have lakes that look like this. Right? Imagine having a dinner plate of water, filled with water, in a car going 100 miles an hour. If that car sped up, slowed down, or turned the slightest bit, that water is going to slosh all over the place. But we have lakes that look like this. Neil deGrasse Tyson, the high priest of scientism, he says because of the spin of the Earth, the water bulges at the equator 14 miles high. 14 miles high. An airplane flies about 5 miles high. So when you're flying from America to South America, at what point do you triple your altitude just to skim across a hump of water? And the answer is never, because airplanes fly straight and level over the Earth plane. So real quick, and then I'll throw it over to you guys. Most people that think Flat Earth is stupid think that we think Flat Earth is this. Nobody, no Flat Earther thinks this. Just Globers think this because this is from the Flat Earth Society. If you Google Flat Earth, you end up at Flat Earth Society images, website. All of their stuff is a government-controlled disinformation site to make you discount Flat Earth. A little bit of truth in there and a lot of nonsense. This is not what we believe. So if we don't believe that, we don't believe that we're a disc floating in space with other disc or round planets. We don't believe any of that. That's nonsense. That's the heliocentric nonsense model. So what is Flat Earth? Well, we live in what I call the Antarctic Basin. Antarctica is the highest land on Earth. Antarctica is not a continent at the bottom of the ball that's the highest land on Earth. Antarctica is the container of our ocean pond. Right? If you put all the oceans together, this is a big pond, a lake. And we have all of the islands. The continents are surrounded by water, but the water needs a container. Large bodies of water at rest lay flat, scientifically, testably, observably, measurably flat. But they need a container, right? Anything bigger than a 5-gallon bucket of water at rest lays flat, testably, measurably flat. And then it needs a container, because if you went swimming in a lake and I said the side of the lake disappeared, all the water's gone, right? This is the side of our lake. This is the edge of our lake. So if you go to the edge of the earth, you're not going to fall off. You're at Antarctica. Here's the question, though. What's out here in the outer space, right? This pink line represents 60 degrees south. Nobody is independently allowed to explore beyond 60 degrees south. That's crazy. So back in the 1940s and 50s, Admiral Byrd did some exploration out there, and he said, beyond the poles, difficult on a globe, is land bigger than the United States, filled with resources that no human has ever stepped foot upon, right? That's going on. And he said this, and then literally that same year, they came up with the Antarctic Treaty, right? Antarctic Treaty that says nobody is allowed to independently explore Antarctica until the year 2041. A whole bunch of nations signed on, and then years later, all of the nations in the world signed on. It's the only treaty that has lasted the test of time on anything. No treaty, no matter what, has lasted as long as this, and you can't even question this until the year 2041. What are they hiding in Antarctica, which I call the outer space? Maybe there's more land out there. Maybe there's more continents. There's a lot of information pointing to that. There's old maps that have been found, like this one, Japanese map showing like 30, 40 continents outside of Antarctica, right? Maybe it's something like this. Maybe there's other lands, extra territory in the outer space. If you lived here in the outer space on the extra terra, extra land, and you came to visit, you might be considered an extraterrestrial from outer space. Okay, they're always telling us what they're doing. Okay, so that's a quick view of what it is. Let's go into your questions, like any question you have, any objection, whatever, and then let me see if I can answer it.
Well, go ahead, Chris.
Yeah, I mean, so my theory, my idea of what the flat Earth is, always of what you were saying, is that globe view. So I want to kick things off. Where was day one for you for finding out the Earth is flat? Like, what led you to where you are today? I think that'd be an interesting story.
Yeah, so I did a conspiracy podcast called Deep Inside the Rabbit Hole, and where we're looking into all sorts of conspiracies and all stuff that's going on. You know, the New York event, all these other things. And in the third year, people started sending me, hey, Dave, have you looked into Flat Earth? I'm like, yeah, delete. That's funny. And then they kept posting stuff, you know, and it's like, hey, you got to look at this. You got to watch this video. 2-minute video. Just watch this. Watch this. And I wouldn't watch it. I wouldn't watch a 2-minute video. It's dumb. I banned people from our social media for even suggesting that I look. And then one day I was talking with another researcher who I respect very much. And she said, Dave, I think the Earth might be flat. And I'm like, not you too. And she goes, here, watch these videos. And I said, all right, I'm going to watch these videos. And I went in with a closed mind. I said, okay, those are interesting, but I'm going to just prove the globe and put this to bed. And for 2 weeks, I am watching video after video. I'm like, okay, there's plenty of reasons. Aristophanes proved it 2,000 years ago with his sticks and shadows, boats over the horizon. You know, Bill Nye, the lion guy with the bow tie, he taught us that. You know, day and night, seasons, all this stuff, you know, airplane routes. I'm like, everything that I thought was a proof either works on both, which we'll get into some things, or absolutely proves that we don't live on a spinning ball, right? The distances that we can see, like if we had a ball, you know, the Earth is 24,901 miles around. Didn't know that then. Now I know it, now that I know more about the globe than I ever did before. There's a certain distance that we should be able to see. According to globe math, a 6-foot-tall person standing at the edge of a calm sea shouldn't be able to see the surface of the water after 3 miles. There's a 6-foot drop in 3 miles. According to globe math, 6-foot drop in 3 miles. So if I'm standing there, my physical horizon should be 3 miles away. And you know that just from thinking, you can see way farther than that. So I watched all these videos of people zooming in on things. Like right here, you don't see a boat, right? Because supposedly it went over the curve. But if you zoom in, increasing that angle, all of a sudden you can see there is a boat there. I just couldn't see it. So watch, I'm going to zoom all the way in on this boat, and we can see the entire side of the boat. And as I zoom out, which is the same as the boat just going away, you'll see that the boat disappears from the bottom up for several reasons. These little waves in the front are blocking it, angular resolution, it's getting smaller, and it disappears, but it's not over the curve because that's provable. I just zoomed in on it, right? If it went behind a physical horizon, which there is no physical horizon, it's an optical horizon, and I'll show you that six ways to Sunday as we talk, I shouldn't be able to zoom it back in, but I can. So that proves right there it's an optical thing. Like this hallway, if I went down this hallway and went around that corner, and I gave you any telescope you want, could you zoom in and see me again? No, you can't, because there's a physical horizon here, right? If I flip this over and pretend this is the Earth, smaller model of the Earth, of course, and I'm over that hump, you can't zoom in and see me because there's a physical horizon. But the way things work is you go into the distance, here's the land, here's the sky, it all comes together. So if there's a boat on my hand, in the distance it comes together, and you can't see that boat. But if you zoom in, you open up that angle and you can see it. So that's how we see things too far. And so they tell us the radius of the Earth, the radius from the center of the Earth to the surface is just under 4,000 miles, right? So here's the curve of the Earth. The distances that we are able to see with today's consumer optics require a radius of over 250,000 miles versus the 4,000 that they're telling us, okay? Curvature has never been seen, ever, right? They keep moving the globe post every time we show them, nope, this is flat there. Like, oh, no, you have to be higher. You have to be 70,000 feet. No, you have to be 120,000 feet. Oh, you know, Felix Baumgarten, Baumgartner, whatever his name is, the Red Bull guy, you know, he couldn't even see curvature, right?
That's the guy who went up in the balloon. Jumped up.
Yeah, he went up in the Red Bull jump. And the funny thing is they did two jumps prior to that using regular cameras. And then the third one, the one that they televised, they used GoPro cameras that have fisheye lenses. And the fisheye lens bends, as you probably know, bends things. So this is what Felix saw. But we took this and we zoomed in and we looked, look at this river, look at these land features. This is all New Mexico, all of it. This is all New Mexico. This is a fisheye lens. And when he opened up his door to look out when they first got there, the horizon is flat and at eye level because it was not a fisheye lens in there. And we also took a shot of when he climbed in when it was on the ground, and it had the same flat, same level, exact horizon on the ground, and at 127,000 feet. The horizon.
Is that the video you were playing at the very beginning?
No, that was 120,000 feet, a little bit lower, but it's still flat. Still flat. And here's the other thing is, think about this. The Earth is spinning at 1,000 miles an hour to the east. That's what they tell us. He went up for 3.5 hours. Now, the Earth is spinning to the east. He should land 3,000 miles out in the ocean, in the west. But guess what? He landed east of where he took off. Like 100 miles east of where he took off. So one, not only did he keep up with the spin of the Earth in space, the edge of space, he outran the Earth. It's nonsense. The Earth is stationary. This is stationary. Yeah, it's crazy. Listen, this stuff, today I am going to show you things that you never thought about. And I do not want you.
You already are.
I do not want you at the end of the show going, holy crap, the Earth is flat. Just say, holy crap, there's so much that I need to look into, okay? I need to verify this shit myself.
That's fair.
Sure. Yeah. That's a big theme of our show to begin with.
Yeah.
No. Let me ask you if we could go back real quick to the to the map that you were showing us, and how outside of Antarctica there was that extra space.
Yeah.
So where does that space, where would that space theoretically end? And where is this map that we're all standing on?
Yeah.
Where is it in the universe, or where is it exactly in reality, I guess you could say, is my question.
Great question. We can talk about that, but let me just clarify in saying that anything beyond the shoreline of Antarctica or anything higher than we can get to ourselves is speculation. We don't know, okay? I say we don't live in the solar system. We live in the Earth system, Okay. The Earth is a massive plane. I call it an extended plane. I don't want to say it's an infinite plane like infinite space. I say it's an extended plane. I don't know how far it goes. Okay. I don't know anything other than what's here, other than places that I've been, other places that I can verify, right? It appears that Antarctica is bigger than all of the oceans and all of the continents combined. Maybe a million times bigger, maybe a billion times bigger. Maybe there's other lands beyond Antarctica like this, right? There's also stories from our disjointed history, like it's one of them called the Iron Republic, about a senator that in the 1800s got a ship after he retired, and he went to Antarctica and he found an opening, and he was like going through exploring Antarctica, and all of a sudden they came back out in the ocean and they were lost. They couldn't navigate. They couldn't find the North Star. They couldn't, didn't know where they were for about a month. And then they came across some land and a boat came out, and the boat said, "Hey, you know, where are we?" They're like, this is the Iron Republic. Where are you from? Or we're from America. Like, where's the Iron Republic? And the guy in the boat said, "We're on the other side of Antarctica, about the same distance you are from Antarctica." And they're like, "What?" And they went in, and this is in like 1901. The guy wrote these articles. And he's talking about flat screen televisions and computers and floating cars and a whole different society. And the story was, and again, story, unverifiable, These people didn't like the tyranny that was going on in the 1600s. So they left and they moved to the outer space, right? So more advanced civilizations living out here. I did this talk with Sophia Smallstorm. You can find it on my YouTube channel, DITRH, called The Outward Flow of Civilizations. It may be where the Mayans and the Incas and all of these previous civilizations, they moved outwards with a sun that moved outwards. So a lot to take in. This is speculation. I'd rather talk about things that we can prove and measure here within our realm.
Yeah, right. Gotcha. You got it. Chris, go ahead.
Yeah, so something that you threw me off with was this treaty and this rule that you can't go past a certain line in Antarctica. Can you expand on that? When did that start?
So the Antarctic Treaty.
That's interesting.
Yeah, yeah, it's fascinating. So Antarctic Treaty was in 1959, and literally we're having wars for resources and territory all over the world, and all of a sudden he goes, "Oh, we found more land bigger than Antarctica." But they go, "Oh, no one can go there. No one, no corporation, no one's even allowed to question the treaty," right? So people go, "Well, you can go to Antarctica. You know, yeah, you can go to that little peninsula. It'll cost you $10,000 to $50,000 to go for like 3 days. You're not allowed off the ship most of the time. No one's allowed to explore out there. And, you don't really see anything. They'll show you some penguins and some ice, you know," and they say, the reason that you can't go over Antarctica is because we have to preserve the migratory path of the penguins. This is before environmentalism was even a word. And we have to protect the ice. It's the only pristine place on Earth. And the third reason is military, because we're afraid the Russians will sneak up underneath the Earth and attack us. That's interesting.
Yeah, I'm doing a little bit of, Googling on it. And yeah, it sounds like a military treaty of some sort during the Cold War, basically. You know, we don't want anybody to claim this land.
It's still in place today. No one's allowed to go there. It'll cost you between $200,000 and $2 million to apply for a permit. It'll take a year or two before they deny you and keep your money. Okay? Nobody is allowed to go there. They stop you by force. Well, how do they stop you by force? That's a big area. And they're all of the islands that surround the outside of our pond, from the Falkland Islands to all these other little islands, are run by the Crown. They're military bases. And if you try to go near Antarctica, you will be stopped by force. And several explorers have been stopped, turned around, sent home, even though they got permission from their countries, and they were jailed. Okay? They are serious. Nobody can go there. But we can deforest the Amazon. That's fine. You know, we can do whatever. But no one is allowed to go to explore the outer lands of Antarctica. Now, they'll claim people have gone across, like Colin O'Brady. But when you look at his,
I was just gonna mention him. Yeah, I'm familiar with him.
Yeah. So, but when you look at his actual path, it's nothing like they tell us, right? His actual path. He went from, I think, from Santiago. Maybe he kind of just like went over here, and then went over here, and it was picked up, okay? This is ridiculous, right? So let's talk about, because this will transition into what circumnavigation is, right? So, you know, people, you can leave New York and go east and end up back in New York, right? Does that prove we're on a globe? Absolutely not. Here's the flat Earth. At the center of the flat Earth is a magnetic mountain, we think. There's a magnetic force because all compasses will point to it. Now, here's a compass I have, and the needle's pointing north. I'm trying to push this compass west, but I have to keep turning the compass to maintain a dead reckoning west, okay? And if I try to go east, same thing. East is on this side of the compass, but I have to keep that needle pointing to the center, so I have to turn. East and west are circles. You can go east, go around the pond, and come right back to where you started from. All right? But now if I try to dead reckon west, watch what happens. If I don't adjust to the north, I'm immediately heading south. South is every direction away from the center. Every straight line ends up going south. Okay? Now, if you want to prove the Earth is a globe, you can go south, go over here, and pop up over here. That would prove the Earth is a globe. But you can't. When you go south, you just go away, right? Nobody has gone south and popped up on the other side of the ball because we don't live on a ball. The Earth is flat.
Interesting. There was a question I have.
Go.
I have a question regarding perspective.
Yes.
Of the stars and the planets, etc. Yes. I'm a pretty big astronomy guy. I have a telescope. I like just looking at the stars and planets, sometimes the moon.
I took 4 years of astronomy in college, so I'm all about it. Go ahead.
Yeah, I took a class too. How do you explain the difference in perspective if you're looking at the stars? For example, if you're in the northern hemisphere and you look up at the sky, you'll see a different set of stars as opposed to if you travel down to the southern hemisphere, you'll see a different set of stars in the sky, like on the same day. I mean, it could be technically done if you flew. Yeah.
Great question. So let's make a miniature model of the world. We're in a room, 10-foot high ceilings, recessed lights. Those are the stars. And you and I are in this room and we're looking up and we see the lights in the sky, right? The lights in the ceiling. Right. So now we're going to expand that room out to 10 miles, 10 mile long room. Even a mile would do it, but let's say 10 miles. So I'm standing here and I've got the stars above me. You go 5 miles in the other direction. I'm not even going to be able to see you because the ceiling and the floor are going to merge together. And I say, okay, 1, 2, 3, look up. You're going to look up and see completely different stars that I see. You're going to see completely different lights. Because you are on the other side of the room. And, you know, if you've ever been to Las Vegas, they have hotels. The hallways are so long that the ceiling and the floor almost meet from one end to the other. Right? That's just in a friggin' hotel. It's like, a quarter of a mile, not even. Okay? So in the flat Earth, we have a ceiling above us with fixed stars. Okay? And as you move away, they get lower in the sky to the point where they merge into the atmospheric layer. Everything gets compressed together and you can't see them because they're too far away. That's it. It's that simple.
So my understanding is, I mean, it's called flat Earth, but it's almost as if there's like I don't know why I'm using the term, but like an astral plane that everything is kind of on. That's the way I'm kind of understanding it, like the universe, the Earth, etc., all on like a plane almost.
So
it's kind of the way I'm understanding it.
Yeah. So the question is, you know, what's underneath the Earth?
Yeah, that's a good question.
I was going to say, yes. Yeah. That was the next question for me. Yeah.
So the deepest hole ever dug, flat Earth or globe Earth, is just 7.5 miles, just short of 8 miles. And while they were digging it, they were using ground penetrating radar to see what they're going to hit next. And they were wrong every step of the way. Okay, no more water, they hit water. No more rocks, they hit rocks, right? So the ground penetrating radar was ridiculous. They could not figure out. So that's equivalent to a drilling halfway through the thin skin of an apple, okay, for size, right? They couldn't even guess what was in the half of the skin of the apple, but all of a sudden they know the next 4,000 miles to the center. This is a meme. This is a joke. Okay, you know what the Curie point is? If you take a magnet and heat it to a certain temperature, it reaches the Curie point. That's when it loses its magnetism.
Yep.
Long before it melts. They tell us there's a molten magnetic core 4,000 miles down when they couldn't tell us what was in the first 7.5 miles. This is a meme. This is pseudoscience. This is a joke. They need this to explain their crazy heliocentric ball. It's absolutely ridiculous.
So you don't believe that the core is magnetic then, right? But what about, you know, let's use lava, for example, that comes out of the ground. I mean, we could all agree that I'd say that we've seen it, or, you know, believe that it exists.
100%, except you're not going to like this. But first, let me go this. This was a 2014 image of Jupiter. We've all seen it. They also have a big model that looks exactly like this. Interesting. I should pull up that picture. But in 2016, they said, hey, we got a picture of the Northern Lights proving that Jupiter has a magnetic core. One, here's a problem. This is a spinning storm, okay? Every single cloud is exactly the same. It's the same picture. This one's a little bit lighter, and they just put this on it. You don't even need Photoshop for that. You can do that in MS Paint, okay? this is from NASA. That's got to at least raise a flag on the legitimacy of NASA, right? And the fact that the clouds haven't changed in over 2 years, when NASA showed us this over a time lapse of a couple of days, okay? This is nonsense.
Yeah, I do find it weird, or at least frustrating, that a lot of the photos that NASA puts out there of planets, or even, for example, they just recently, you know, put together that photo of the black hole. It's not necessarily like you're taking your camera and taking a direct photo of one of these things. They're, a lot of them are not even colorized. They're putting color to them.
Yeah.
So it loses its authenticity to me, regardless of what you believe, because they're photoshopping a lot of these photos in general to make it look something more like what they claim to be.
Yeah. When you go back to NASA, they don't offer any photographs of any planets. They never call them photographs. They call them images and pictures because that's what they are. Here's a 1978 picture of the Earth, supposedly. This is ridiculous. Okay. And then they said in 2017, look at the pollution. Oh my God, pollution, global warming, right? They forgot to change the clouds. Look at these clouds. Same clouds. Okay,
yeah, I see that.
Are they lazy or are they stupid? Right, the blue marble that was on everyone's iPhone. Okay, the globers, globe believers, will defend these pictures to the end. But NASA admits that they're made in Photoshop. This one was made by Robert Simmons. He did an interview. He talked about he just got strips of data, numbers and values, and he created this in Photoshop. He hit Command Z a lot. He's a lazy Photoshopper. He used the same clouds again and again and again and again, right? He's not even good at it, and he admits it, but people don't care. Go look up, you know, like here's a picture, two different pictures, a few years apart. Look at the United States. Look at the size of the United States. That's absolute insanity to believe that, you know, two images with the same diameter could show the same thing. So here's a little experiment that we can do. Here on Earth, we can drive across Mexico and Baja and say this is 934 miles. We can determine, we can verify this. So here's that segment right here, 934 miles. NASA tells us the diameter of the Earth is 7,917 miles. I should be able to fit 8.5 of these between these two lines. 8.5. See a problem?
Interesting.
Yeah. So again, this is a painting. Anyone that denies it is just being willfully ignorant. So, go ahead.
So then what is, so we forget about the core. I know you said like a magnetic mountain before. What would theoretically be underneath us? Like,
you know, yeah.
Or it could be like, I'm starting to picture maybe it's a bigger sphere almost, or some type of a shape. Because if there is other things past Antarctica, who knows how far it actually goes?
Yeah. So again, with the distances that we can see, we've clocked distances where the diameter from the center to the edge would have to be 275,000 miles versus 4,000 miles. So if you want to go with that story that the Earth is hundreds of times bigger than they're telling us, that's fine, except you have to show me curvature, you have to show me axial rotation. And if the Earth is that much bigger, then every single star and planet and, you know, planet and sun and moon in our solar system has to be that much farther and bigger. Also, none of that works. None of it. So you have to remember, we're corkscrewing through space. Remember, we're corkscrewing through space in four different directions at once. Right? Go out tonight, pick a spot, draw a little chart of where the stars are at a certain specific time, right? We're traveling between this and then next year, same night, same time, we'll be just in the chasing the sun, will be 4.4 billion, billion with a B, miles from where we were last year or this year. And you look up and you see the stars, they will be in the exact same position.
But isn't that because they're also traveling through the galaxy and through space at a, you know, at a fixed rate themselves?
That's not what they're telling us. They're telling us that everything's going, everything's spiraling around. None of the stars have ever changed. But NASA will tell us that they can tell the distance. They can tell the distances to stars or the size of stars by looking at two stars that are in line with each other, you know, at different distances. And they watch them in January. And then 6 months later in June, they look at them again when we're 186 million miles on the other side of the sun. And they say, oh, the parallax there, that tells us how far they are. So they're telling us that there's parallax. Parallax is when you're moving and things change positions. That there's parallax at 186 million miles, but not the 4.4 billion miles. Okay, here's the problem. Here's the problem. They throw these numbers at us that people's brains just melt. They don't know how to process these numbers because we were taught to memorize and regurgitate the Rockefeller information versus actually think. Think about this. They tell us that, sticking on this for one more second, you guys know about the Georgia Guidestones?
Yes, I've heard of them, yeah.
No.
Okay. Well, they're in 1981, this monument stuck up, which basically is laying out the game plan of what's going on today. It's saying that they want to depopulate the planet to 500 million, but that's a whole nother story. But there's a hole, a thin little hole, and that if you look through that hole, and you have to remember, we're corkscrewing through space in all these different directions, what do you see? You see Polaris. It never moves, our North Star. You do a time lapse, all the stars spin around it, okay? Polaris never moves. This, if we were corkscrewing, going all through space in all these different directions, Polaris would move in like seconds, let alone it's been up for 40 plus years, right? Pyramids, which are way older, they still line up with the same stars. Nothing's moved. This is telling you that the stars that we see, the lights in the sky, are in fixed positions. They look nothing like what NASA tells us. Our optics have outgrown their lies. Okay, we look up with consumer level super zoom lenses, and we see something completely, completely different than what they're telling us. If we look at Mars, this is what Mars really looks like when you zoom in on it. Okay, this is here within our solar system, within our Earth system, not solar system.
Yeah, I've actually seen that exact, it that exact way before myself using a phone and telescope.
Right. And then here's a star. This is Sirius. Here's the star Arcturus. This is Arcturus, right? This is not a star billions and billions and trillions of miles away. This is Capella. Amazing. These things are here within our solar system. Go ahead. Go ahead.
What is a star to a flat earther then? Because I always was curious, you know, I never associated it with the Earth being flat, but all stars are lights and some are so far away that the star could have already burnt out by the time it got here. How has the North Star not been burnt out yet?
I say, cool story, bro. Cool story. The whole idea of stars burning out, that we're seeing their lights from billions of years ago, ridiculous. It's, you got to lose that from your indoctrinated nonsense that you've been taught. So we know that when something goes into the distance, like here's my phone, it's pretty big, yeah. It's getting smaller and smaller and smaller, right? We can calculate over distance its angular size, okay? And we know that a penny with the human eye, I think it's at 200 yards or whatever it is, half a mile, quarter of a mile, maybe it's way less than that, it becomes too small to see. You have an angular resolution limit of your eye. Anything smaller than 0.20 degrees is invisible to your eye. Your eye is physically incapable of seeing it. Okay. So also another thing is when you take a light into the distance, it gets dimmer and dimmer exponentially. It's called the inverse square law of light. If you double the distance to a light, it's 1/4 of the brightness. All right, double it again, it's 1/4 of that. All right, so that's called the inverse square law of light. So we know, they tell us, that the sun is 93 million miles away, right? If the sun was right next to the Earth, the size of the Daedalus, it would fill the entire sky. Move it 93 million miles away, it's the size of a nickel held up at arm's length, right? You with me?
Mm-hmm. Right.
So if I made it 25 times farther, could you see it? And the answer is absolutely not. Scientifically, we can prove that its size would be way small at just like 3 times the distance. So, but 24 times the distance, we'll say, you can't see it. 24 times the distance is 3 light hours. Okay. So the sun at 3 light hours away would be invisible. 3 light hours, because it's 8 light minutes away times 24 times farther, 3 light hours away, it would be invisible to the human eye. They tell us Polaris is 48 times bigger than the sun. Okay, 3 light hours times 48 times the size would be 6 light days, right? Three hours times 2 days, right? Something like this, whatever it is. 6 light days away, you could not see Polaris at the size that they tell us. 6 light days away. They tell us it's 433 light years away. Okay? This is nonsense. This is absolute pseudoscience bullshit.
So let me ask you a question going back a little bit to, I don't know if we really even talk about this, but what are your thoughts on the moon landing? And all that, really, like the space race between the United States and the Soviet Union.
Yeah, there you go. the whole moon landing is absolute nonsense. Look at this shitty little horizon. Oh, it's 30 feet beyond him. He dropped his hammer and he can't pick it up because he's hanging from wires. Okay, there's so much evidence out there. That, you know, I used to, when I came across this years ago, I'm like, oh, it's, well, they had to fake it because they didn't want the Russians seeing out the real technology that we have. And that's another cool story, bro. Right. This is absolute nonsense. There's so much information, so much video out there of them faking everything. Right. You have to believe that the astronauts that went to the moon landed in this thing. Look at this thing. Look at this thing. And this is the orbiter, right? Look at these motions on it. This is like done in a dark room with a little Airfix model. This is ridiculous when you look into it, okay? It's absolute insanity, the stuff that they show us, you know, on the moon. This is the moon lander, right? There was a car in there, 2 guys wearing diapers, right? And then this thing somehow took off from the moon with these guys in it and met up with the orbiter. Right, with grown men in there, days.
Right. Well, the way I understand is it did have its own booster, right? But since the moon has less gravity, it takes less thrust in order to escape.
Right. And none of the dust under it when it landed moved. None of the dust moved whatsoever. Right.
I haven't seen a video in a while. I don't remember.
And again, once you look at all this stuff, once you see it, you can't unsee it. You know, Buzz Aldrin. Why does he and the other astronauts have their names on the Hollywood Walk of Fame for actors? Because they're actornauts, okay?
Yeah, I'm actually pretty familiar with it. They did shoot a lot of the footage. Like, a lot of the footage is, like, test footage, they say, that, you know, of the moon landing. And it's not, like, some of the most famous videos we see are legitimately in a studio filmed.
Everything that you see is in a studio because the moon isn't even a physical place that you could go to. The moon, you know, and to open your eyes, next time the moon is out in the day sky, look at it. It's right there in the day sky, right? When the moon is out and there's spotted clouds in the sky, you'll notice that the moon only lights up the clouds that are right near it. Well, you can't do that unless that moon is a local light. The moon is not reflecting sunlight, right? This is a picture from them on the moon. This light right here, this dim, dirty reflection looks this bright from Earth. You can read by this in the middle of nowhere. You can drive your car with the lights off because of the moonlight, right? What about the inverse square law of light? This light has to get exponentially dimmer. If you looked at this, and let's say this is 1 lumen. We went halfway to the moon, it's 4 lumens. Halfway again, it's 16. Halfway again, it's 64. Go all the way to 100 miles from the moon. It's brighter than we would see the sun from Earth. It's tens of millions of lumens. According to science, real science, flat earthers love science. We just don't buy pseudoscience.
Right.
Yeah, that's a hot topic of discussion nowadays to begin with. Yeah. Well, you know, try not to go into
religion.
COVID, but yeah, that's you have a good point there.
Okay.
To say at least. Chris, you have a question or?
Yeah. So let's say we agree with you. The earth is flat.
No,
you
know. Don't do that yet.
Hold on. Where?
Theoretically.
Right. So let's say, you know, we're at that point. Why the lies?
This is going to be my great question. Yeah,
What establishment, New World Order, elite, or whatever is behind this? You know what I mean? Like,
what's to be gained from this specific lie? Like, I understand maybe YouTube,
unlimited
like
resources,
lying, or maybe the, you know, to use a pandemic to gain global control. I understand the logic behind. I understand the logic behind that. But why the lie around the earth, you know, shape, size, etc.
Yeah. So the shape of the earth doesn't matter. I don't care about the shape of the earth, nor does anybody. Sure. So these are the people that run the world, whether you know it or not, the Bilderberg Group, the Council of Foreign Relations, the Trilateral Commission. These are the people, undisputed, that are pulling all the strings. Okay. So why the lie? And the answer is because they don't want us to know who we are, where we are, or our true history. Have you guys looked into Tartaria yet? Tartaria and the mud floods? So there was an advanced civilization here in the 1800s. Our entire history from the early 1900s and before is a lie. There was an advanced worldwide civilization here. You know, you can look at the, you know, not just the pyramids. There's so many sites, so many buildings that were supposedly built in the 1600s, 1700s, 1800s when we had horses and buggies that we couldn't even build today, right? These are high antiquitech buildings that were harvesting free energy. It's unreal. So they don't want us to know. You know, there was a reset that happened in the, I think, late 1800s, very late 1800s. And people that came out of it knew the truth of this world and decided to make us all slaves. All right. So here's the thing. Everything that you and all of your listeners have in their lives is because of the way that you think. Your thoughts create the world that the reality that you live in. You know, you are able to manifest things. They don't want you to know that your thoughts create reality, that your words have meanings, that signs and symbols rule the world. Okay, signs and symbols and numbers. They don't want you to know how this place works. They don't want you to know that nobody has authority over you. Nobody has control of you other than in your own imagination. Imagine if everyone woke up tomorrow to the nonsense that's going on in the world right now and just says, no, we're going to go and live our lives. There's nothing we could do. The people that we call the elite, the powers that want to be, they would be powerless. They'd be finished. The only power they have is us complying, us doing what they say. So why does it matter? Why the lie? And the answer is because they're hiding free energy, they're hiding more land, they're hiding more resources, they're hiding knowledge of what's in Antarctica. They're hiding that we are at the center of creation, that we are special, that we are powerful, that we're not spinning out of control, flying through an infinite space vacuum. If your foundation of your thoughts are that we're a speck flying through an infinite vacuum where an asteroid could take us out at any moment, or global warming is happening, false, where we're running out of food, impossible, where we're running out of water, there's endless water, where we're overpopulated, everyone could have a quarter acre in Texas, okay? None of that is true. None of it. But they want us living in fear. They want to limit our thoughts, and they want us plugged into their mind matrix so we can't create the reality that we were given and has been stolen from us. They're not allowed to take away our free will. So they're always telling us. They're always telling us what's going on. So
yeah, I definitely agree with you. Let me ask you a question. Are you an anarchist, Dave?
I would call myself an anarchist, I guess.
Ah, you see? You sound like one just because of the way you're even talking about, our, you know, like our freedom and whatnot. And it's something I've recently come on to. It's, for example, we could talk about how like our constitution and our government is really just like an idea at the end of the day. And everybody chose not to follow it. It doesn't exist in reality. Just like the president has done with just ignoring 100%. Certain standards of governance lately. It's because if you don't choose to believe in it, it doesn't really exist.
100%. That's how they control us, because they control us with just getting us to believe. You know, they warm us up to things like Arthur C. Clarke made up satellites. And then a couple years later, we had satellites. And some royal guy in the 1800s wrote a paper or a book on theorizing on dinosaurs. No one in history before him ever found a single dinosaur bone. And a year later to the day, he discovers the first dinosaurs, right? So they're always predictively programming us. They're telling us that nuclear energy is dirty energy. Nuclear bombs are horrible. Nuclear bombs don't exist, okay? This is all just mind control. It's unreal what's going on here, but once you see it, you can't unsee it. So let me talk about plane routes for a moment, because this one might really
I've seen stuff like this before, the plane routes.
Yeah, so Argentina to India, why don't they just go across and stop, get some fuel somewhere in Africa? There's plenty of airports, but no, they go all the way up here, and this is the route that they take. Makes perfect sense. So NASA is in charge of all radar, flight routes, GPS. They're in charge of everything. Going from Hawaii to New York, they had to make an emergency landing, and they stopped in Seattle. Well, Seattle's right along this line, okay? If we go from Dallas to Beijing, emergency landing in Calgary. Calgary's all the way over here. It's over 1,000 miles out of off course. It's right there. Okay, it goes right here. Bam, Calgary in a straight line. Every one of these emergency landings prove that the Earth is flat. Now, and I'm going to show you another big issue. Here's one emergency landing in Moscow. Boom, Moscow's right on the line. One more, Chicago to Dal, emergency landing again in Moscow. Moscow's up here. It's right along the line. Happens every time. So here's something which is very, very interesting. If you want to go from Santiago to Australia, they go all the way up into the northern hemisphere, across and down. Right? If you want to go to Western Australia, the flight route is all the way up. They go all the way over to China and Singapore and down. Why would they do that? Why wouldn't they just cut across the bottom of the ball?
Okay. I don't know why anybody would want to go to Australia right now. The way that they're treating their citizens and whatnot.
Just wait here. Yeah. It's coming to America. So so remember this one, Western Australia, all the way up, all the way across and down. If you look at that on a flat Earth map, we go all the way up across Singapore, Australia, straight line. Okay. Now, all of these southern flights that go into distant southern locations, they all go into the northern hemisphere. Never, ever once does two locations in the northern hemisphere have a flight route that takes them into the southern hemisphere. Any flight route from any northern location to any other northern location does not cross the equator. But all of these distant flights that are in the south, they do cross the equator. And that's because they're lying. The center of the globe is very similar to the center of the flat Earth. The outside of the flat Earth is nothing like the underside of the globe. And that's the problem. Let me share my app here with you guys, and it might help you see a little better. Okay. This is the Flat Earth Sun, Moon, and Zodiac Clock app. It shows you how the sky is a perfect clock. The sun is the hour hand of our clock, right? They gave us clocks, but they go, you know what? I'm going to make it go around twice to confuse these guys every day. Well, it only goes around once. It's a 24-hour clock, right? The sun keeps track of the hours and the days. The moon, its position and phase, keep track of the weeks and the months. If I speed it up, you'll see that the sun will catch up to the moon, and it'll lap the moon once every 28 days. Huh, there's the moon cycles, okay? So every 28 days, the sun laps the moon. The moon keeps track of the weeks and the months. Used to be called moons. There used to be 13 of them at 28 days each. And so that goes on. Let me slow it down. I'm going to turn on why it's going so fast. I'm going to turn on the stars. And the stars circle around the same way, but they're going slightly faster than the sun. So slightly that it takes 365 times around for the stars to outrun and lap the sun. So right now the sun is in this constellation. This constellation will slowly creep forward, and next month the sun will creep into Capricorn.
Scorpio season.
Yeah, Scorpio. Is that Scorpio? Whatever. I don't know the names of them. So, and then it'll stay in there, and then it'll outrun it and go into the next one, and outrun it, go into the next one. And so that's how the stars keep track of the seasons and the years. So here's how it works. The sun migrates in between the Tropic of Cancer, the inner yellow line, and the Tropic of Capricorn. If I jump it outwards to December, so in December, the sun is out on the Tropic of Capricorn. Australia is having their summer because the sun is high over them, close, right? We're having our winter. Where are you guys, in the United States?
New York area.
Yeah, so I'm in Connecticut. Tri-state. Connecticut. We're having our winter because the sun is way out here, right? They're having their summer because they look up, the sun is over them. We have to look out south, and the sun is farther away and lower. 6 months later, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. The sun moves up to the Tropic of Cancer, and it goes right over Miami. Guess what? It's hot in Miami. The sun's high in the sky. Look, Mexico, California, Baja, it's hot. But people in Australia, it's winter for them. They have to look all the way over. The sun is over there, farther away. It's in the inner north. And here we are. What's in the center? The Arctic. And what's on the outside is the Antarctic. Well, if it was a ball, the Antarctic would be just like the Arctic, but it would be at the other end of the ball and have the same weather and light and everything 6 months apart. But that's not what happens. If you're inside the Tropic of Cancer, what's the sun doing? It's arcing around you. Do you see that? It's making an arc around you. Agreed?
Right.
If you're inside the Tropic of Cancer, it's arcing around you, the Arctic. If you're outside the Tropic of Capricorn, you're in the Antarctic, and it's not arcing around you. It's antarcing towards you and away from you. It doesn't arc around you. So they're telling us with the Antarctic and the Arctic right there what's going on. So here's the challenge I have for people. You know, people, and I was one of these people too. Flat Earth is stupid. You're a moron. Don't breed. And I'm not looking at any of your stupid videos. We all know the Earth is flat. I mean, all of the Earth is a globe. I have a challenge. 3 Bitcoins I'm offering for 1 proof of the globe. And here's the challenge. Every day on the app, there's a featured video down here in the corner. You just tap that thumbnail. Up comes a video. Watch the video every day for 2 weeks. At the end of that 2 weeks, I can pretty much guarantee you will lose the respect of your family and friends because you'll be a flat earther. Okay? But in case you still think the Earth is a globe, send me the proof you win 3 Bitcoins. But before you do, you have to hit this question mark, frequently asked questions, and up comes all of the questions that you're going to ask. Hey, what about eclipses? Hey, what about seasons? Hey, what about ships over the horizon? Right? That's the one that got me. I hit that. Up comes a playlist of videos that YouTube will not serve you. You can search these videos by name, and they're going to serve you propaganda nonsense videos. Watch these videos, and then go out and get your own equipment and test it yourself, all right? So it has tons of information. If you hit the web button, up comes tons of other resources. Our interview will be here under DITRH Interviews. This is my channel. Cool. Nice short videos. Down on the bottom right, Mud Floods Tataria. If you click that button, bring food and water, call the boss, you're not working for the next couple days. Okay. All right.
Going down the rabbit hole on that
going
one.
Going down the rabbit hole. Books, anyone, you know, if you're a book person, great stuff. 16 emergency landings. I showed you a few of the stuff that absolutely prove flat Earth. Every single one of them, if you draw a line from the origin to the destination, the emergency landing is on that line. And the places that they land on the globe make absolutely no sense whatsoever. But the other thing that we just added to the app, besides that, we have images, right? So all of these images, like, you know, if you want to just pull up information, if you want to learn.
Yeah, so some of the stuff you've been showing us in the background, right?
Yeah. So all stuff there. But another thing is, when you become a flat earther, if people say, you know, it's kind of lonely, I wish I had some other flat earthers around you. Well, guess what? They're everywhere. You hit that handshake button, up comes all of the flat earthers that are in your area. Every one of those dots is a flat earther. Okay. And if I click on one of them, up comes a person, and I could click their thing and send them a message. You can communicate and say, hey, you're just in the next town over. Meet me over at Casey's Bar and Grill. We're gonna have a beer.
Right. Seems like there's not much privacy even in the flat Earth community.
Well, but here's the thing. Right now, if you look right here, I have, this is called approximate location. It has my dot within 5 miles of where I am. Okay.
Gotcha.
And it moves me around. If I hit the button above it, it'll show my exact location, and I could also just turn it off. Right. So
yeah.
So again, when I first did it, I'm like, oh man, tracking, being a conspiracy theorist or actually a truth seeker, you don't want people tracking you. But guess what? The government does not need my app to know where you are, what you're saying, or what you're doing. They already know. This is helping us use their technology to connect, because they want us apart. They want us face diapered. They want us doing what they want. They want us not being near each other, not talking to each other, because they know that the power of us together. Like, I'm a pretty brave guy, when I fight tyranny. But when I have somebody with me, I'm 100 times braver, right?
Yes. Every 100% agree.
Yeah. So they want us apart. It's all division. Like all these countries, like, hey, wouldn't Russia expose us for faking the moon landing? It wasn't a space race. It's nonsense. All of the division of countries, fake. It's all fake. They divided us by countries, by religions, by sexes, by races, by sports teams, by genders, by, vaxxed, unvaxxed. They're just dividing because they don't want us together, because together they lose.
Yeah. Well, we've been trying to promote that for a while now. We came together for this podcast to try and wake up anybody we could.
Yeah. And by the way, not everyone wants to wake up, which is that's their journey.
We just learned that.
I just heard a great quote saying, you can't wake up someone that's pretending to be asleep.
Yeah.
And I was like, wow, man, if that ain't true nowadays, I don't know what is.
Yeah, that's a good one. And people are like, what about the space station? Look, I'm on the space station. Right? It's that friggin' easy. And they make so many mistakes with their green screens and whatnot. It's
Right now, look, I'm in space myself too.
I'm on the moon. You're watching the moon. That whole moonrise thing is complete and total nonsense. And I showed this for a second. We didn't talk about it. In 1964, for $34 million, they made this all amazing, SR-71. And then in 1972, for $50 million, they made this homeless tweaker shelter.
Well, that I could probably attest to the fact that the military budget is always insanely large compared to any other budget. So,
NASA gets $64 million every day, okay? And they built this papier-mâché thing, okay? $64 million a day, right? It's complete and total nonsense, right?
Yeah. It was pretty crazy.
Yeah, it was interesting. Yeah, definitely. Yeah. It's definitely. I feel like a lot of the negative connotations around flat earthers are bullshit. We've come to learn a lot of the negative connotations around anybody, honestly, is mostly bullshit. We're seeing that right now with the vax on vax stuff.
And it's funny too how you started this off by saying, "Oh, that's flat earth society," where they even have a place to go to propagandize flat earth, view on being a flat earther is different from the society where I kind of would have gotten some of my information from.
Obama plugged the flat earth society a half a dozen times during his presidency. We don't have time for a meeting of the flat earth society, because that's where he wants you to go. Okay. Yeah. Because that's nonsense. Let me, we're going to run out of time.
Sure.
Let me show you, here's how we can prove the earth is flat. The earth is flat or globe. Here's how we can prove the globe in one day, and it will not cost millions of dollars, and it's undeniable. Get two airplanes, fly a whole bunch of people to Antarctica here, fuel up the planes. Okay. You, me, Neil deGrasse Tyson, a bunch of scientists, teachers, everybody. Okay. And then you take an airplane and you fly maybe 1,000 feet in the air and you follow the coastline around Antarctica. Okay. So when you're 1,000 feet in the air, you can see how fast you're going. You can see the coastline. You can confirm this is where you're going. So everyone's looking out the left window. This one, everyone's looking out the right window. This is, they tell us, is 13,000 miles around. Well, a plane, 6,500 miles. That would be, 12 hours or so. They should end up on, both airplanes should meet over here, right? Piece of cake. The problem is, one, they'll never do it because they can't do it. They're not allowed to do it. And the last person to try to circumnavigate Antarctica was Captain Cook. And he went, it took him over 3.5 years in a boat. And he went 60 and 80,000 miles. I think he tried it three times. 60 to 80,000 miles. That's because he's going all the way around like this. He's not going around a little island at the bottom of the
ball. And that's trying to get around Antarctica, right?
That's right. Here's Antarctica, right? Okay. Right? Here's Antarctica. But here's the thing. People go, wouldn't pilots can just go east and come back? If I put you on a racetrack that was 50 miles in a perfect circle, you would think you're going in a straight line. You would not even notice that you're turning to the right a tiny little bit, right? That's just a 50-mile track. Well, these are much bigger circles, right? Your compass is telling you you're dead reckoning east, and you end up right back to where you started from because you went around. You went east or west. Billions of people have circumnavigated east and west. Zero people have gone south, right? And again, you talk about Colin O'Brady. It's when you look at their his tracks and his whole story, it's dumber. It's crazier than NASA. It's absolutely insane. This is I'm looking for a different map. I was looking for Amelia Earhart. I have her trip around. She just did the same exact thing that I was telling you about. She went in a circle. Here we go. Amelia Earhart. Here are all the stops. Basically, just went east, or west, whichever way she went. And that's how she circumnavigated the world. Right?
Interesting.
Billions of people have done it east and west. Zero have done it north and south. Airplanes don't fly upside down. They fly airplane straight and level over the Earth plane.
Gotcha.
Interesting.
Right? NASA. Yeah.
Good points. I like
it. their logo is a snake tongue. What does that tell you? What does that tell you?
Oh, I never even thought of that. You're right. Yeah, it does look like a snake tongue.
Well, I think NASA in Hebrew means to deceive.
It absolutely does. So here's one more quick thing. This is the ZQ pilot. He was going to do southern circumnavigation. You could track them online. And we're like, all right, this is going to be very interesting. North Pole, Alaska, over here, California, these islands up here. Went to Santiago. He went to the South Pole, supposedly. Then he said, well, the weather was too bad. We have to turn around and we'll come back up to Brazil. And we're like, all right, well, he didn't do it. Guinness Book gave him the record for circumnavigation, right? Map that on a flat earth. He went here, he touched, he turned around and came back. That's not circumnavigation. That's not southern circumnavigation. Southern circumnavigation is Santiago to popping up over here and coming right back. Okay? Right. He went to the end of the street, touched the pole, turned around and came back. Okay?
Interesting. That's what you meant.
Yeah.
All right.
So
listen, man, thank you for joining us. Why don't you shout out for everybody where they can find you?
The best place is the Flat Earth, Sun, Moon, and Zodiac Clock app. If you can't remember that name because it's long and obnoxious and you can't scan this QR code, just go to flatearthdave.com and my podcast is there. You'll find lots of stuff. My YouTube channel is the initials for Deep Inside the Rabbit Hole, D-I-T-R-H. And I got all short videos there. But again, you can find everything at flatearthdave.com, which is the Flat Earth Podcast website. And check out the app. The app's $3, one-time charge. There is a subscription that you can or cannot get. You don't need it. You can just say, nope, no subscription, and it goes away. There's no ads. There's no nothing. Just read the reviews in the App Store if you're unsure. It's the highest-rated app in the App Store and the Google Play Store. Be careful. Make sure it's by Blue Water Bay. It's actually Blue Water Bay Pay, it says. In the Flat Earth Society by the Ron Media Group has a app that stole my name, stole the images, really? Stole everything. Wow. But it's horrible. It's a gatekeeping app. I get tons of emails of people going, your app sucks, blah, blah, blah. It's not my app. Okay. My app is the highest rated app in the App Store.
There
Check
we go.
It out and take the challenge. Watch the stuff. For one thing is you'll never be bored again. And you'll be like, wow. And guess what? Here's the thing. I had a thing called Exposing the Big Three, 9/11, Sandy, and Boston. And I say, if I can show people how those were not what they told us, they'll wake up and people just go right back to sleep. You wake people up to the truth of our world, it does something to them. It changes who they are. It makes you more powerful because I'm standing here with my feet firmly planted on terra firma that's not moving. I am at the center of creation. Somebody else is spinning out of control, lost in space, doesn't know where they are or who they are or the powers of their mind. Okay? Mind is where reality is. Mind, it creates reality, and they don't want you to know that.
I like the way you put that.
That's some deep philosophical.
Yeah. Later.
All right. Thanks.
Thank you so much, man.
Send me a link when this is up, and I'll put it on the app. All right.
Definitely.
Thanks, guys. See ya.
All right. Bye. See you later. Want to sign us off, Cap?
Yeah. Doom Nation. It's been another great episode. This was way different than what I thought it was going to be. It was awesome.
Yeah.
Dave, thank you again. Make sure you guys check him out. Make sure you guys like, share, and subscribe. Adios, Doom Nation.
Later.
See you guys.
You all love the Flat Earth Sun, Moon, and Zodiac Clock app, the best tool to show your friends and strangers how the Flat Earth actually works. But are you ready for a Flat Earth app game changer? A new feature has been added. But first, a reminder of some of the existing features. Video of the day. World time. See what time it is all around the Flat Earth. A true Earth compass that shows true navigation across and around the Flat Earth plane. Weather. Tap for detailed local weather information. Know what phase and where the moon is at all times. Watch the sun travel between the tropics for the seasons. Select an amazing background. Add a countdown to your next big date. Video playlists in different languages. See the real trade winds circling the Flat Earth. Top 21 frequently asked questions with quick pop-up video answers. Access to the best photos and gifts at your fingertips. Flat Earth books and merchandise and more. Now, the game changer upgrade we've always dreamed of having. After a year in development, our app just went next level. You're now able to find Flat Earth app users near you. See where they are and send them an instant message in the app. Instantly arrange for a Flat Earther meetup. When activated, blue dots mark the location of the app users near you. You have three choices on showing your location. PP, to pinpoint. This marks your exact location. CC, for city center, which will place you within a few miles of your current location. Or turn off, which removes you from the map altogether. Use it when traveling, or when you're out for a day at the beach, or while eating out somewhere. Find out where other Flat Earthers are and connect. Find like-minded Flat Earth app users and regain your sanity. The Flat Earth Sun, Moon, and Zodiac Clock app is the best tool to show your friends and strangers how our Flat Earth actually works.